is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand.
Live off the record with Zhivargo Laing is sponsored by CG Atlantic, Fidelity Bank of Bahamas, RF Bank and Trust, and Royal Star Assurance.
Welcome to Z Live, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We're so glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. So sorry for the delay, but unfortunately, matters arose that made it quite difficult. And I didn't want to cancel on you and replay, so I hugged it out. And thank you for your patience, and we apologize again for the late start. If you want to give us a call, please feel free to do so on 323-6232. That's 323-6232. Or you can text us on 325-4316, 325-4316, or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796. That's 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. That's 439-3043. So A couple of things I'm observing in the papers and wanting to comment on today. So, in respect of the pharmacists and the grocers, both of whom have essentially, well, mostly the grocers, said like to the government, go ahead and do what you got to do then, because we can do what we have to do. That's essentially what the grocer said, right? Now, the law is the law. So if the law says thou shalt do X and you don't do X, you're breaking the law, okay? So grocers, if the grocers are out there with price control regulations, putting a certain a regulation on their prices, if they do not obey the law, they are breaking the law. It doesn't matter whether you agree with the law or not, you know. You're breaking the law if the law has been duly established by the state, by the legislature. Let's be clear about that. Once the government of the Bahamas passes a law, that is the law of the land. There's no provision in the Constitution that says it is only the law of the land if you like it. It is only the law of the land if you find it convenient. It's only the law of the land if you're comfortable with it. It's the law of the land. And when you breach it, you are in breach of the law of the land. So if the grocers do not apply the regulated prices of breadbasket items, they will be in breach of the law. They will be unlawful grocers. That's the reality. Now, if the grocers decide this law is unjust and therefore decide to break it as a matter of civil protest, because I don't think the penalty for breach of the breach of the price control, I don't think that it's a criminal offense. I don't think so. So therefore it must be a civil offense and there may be fines or the like to be applied. And if you agree that it is, if you say, if the grocers say that's an unjust law, we don't think it's right, and they're therefore making a civil protest against that law, then all that is required is for them to abide by the fines that will be in, that will be applied if they're prosecuted and found guilty of said breach of law. That's fine. You can, that's what you call civil, you know, protest. What did Martin Luther King those call it now? Whenever you protest against the law by breaking it, then you have to be prepared to pay the price for said breach. Okay, so the grocers have made that stance, it seems. Zhivargo Laing says if the regulations are in place and they are violating that regulation, they are acting unlawfully. Okay. Then you have the government that says you have to follow the law. The government says you have to follow the law. You have to follow the law. That's what the government says. You have to follow the law. And the government is being very stiff-necked with that. The government is saying, no, we put the law down, we lay the law down. So now the government is being accused of being arrogant in their actions, strong-handed in their conduct. Are they? Now, this gets a little tricky. This gets a little tricky. Because in a sense, right, in a sense, you know, you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't have your cake and eat it too. You know what that means? That means, like, you can't put a piece of the cake in your mouth to eat it and at the same time say, I have the cake in my hand. You can't do that, right? So there's a couple of history things here that I want to point to. I recall when we were in office, that you remember that the seatbelt laws were passed, right? You remember that? And the seatbelt laws had penalties attached to them. This was just prior to an election that the seatbelt law was passed. And when the Progressive Liberal Party assumed office, they, I believe, instructed the commissioner of police and indicated that they would not enforce that law, but would in fact, give some period of time for people to get accustomed to it. I remember that. And then a big debate ensued about whether in fact the commissioner of police could discretionarily have his officers not enforce the law. Remember that? Right? Yeah, I remember that, right? Because at the time, this was the argument put forward by the Progressive Liberal Party. The Progressive Liberal Party argued poor people would be unduly disadvantaged by this, and that this was a harsh penalty, and people didn't have that kind of money, and so forth. Remember that? And so they argued that there should be some period of leniency for allowing people to adjust to this law, right? And when the Free National Movement at the time would have indicated, well, you know, the law is the law, and the commissioner has no discretion in deciding whether he can obey the law or not, you know, the accusation was that the FNM was cold, was not caring, was not thinking about the people. Something, how political calculations go at times. And again, don't get me wrong, that politicians act like politicians and politicians do politics makes good sense to me, because politicians will do politics. And I want to show you the calculation. I just want to show it to you. The calculation is, how many grocers are there? Let's say there's 1,000 grocers. Who are these people? They are business owners. How are business owners perceived? oh, as money grubbing, money making, greedy people whose lives are so wonderful, they don't care about nobody else. There's 1,000 of them. They're not. There's a generous sentiment that people, they're not poor. They've been, you heard people say it right on this show and other shows. They've been making all these profits all these years and raking in the millions. You hear it. People have no clue about these people's lives. They have no clue about the way they live. All they know is they're open for business. I'm paying them cash. They must be making plenty of money and so forth. But there's 1,000 of them. They're elites, rich, not hurting. Versus the tens of thousands of consumers, many of whom are perceived as scraping it, trying to make ends meet, trying to decide which bill to pay, robbing Peter to pay Paul, which is very true for some, very, very true for some, maybe even many. You know, that's not untrue. But it's thousands of them. 1,000 grocers. Thousands of them that vote. 1,000 grocers that vote too. But, you know, they don't want the ones who carry the weight of political force in the country. So who are you going to back? It's the question. That's the political question. Having made a move to, as the story goes, benefit these thousands of poor people hurting in the crisis, in the inflation crisis, at the disadvantage of these 1,000 grocers who are rich and making lots of money, who are you gonna back? Listen to me, that's an easy political calculation. Even if the public policy ain't right on the politics, the calculation is quite simple. Quite simple. The numbers just don't work in favor of the grocers, don't work in favor of the pharmacists. They don't. As a political calculation, it does not work that way. Does not work that way. Because again, I can dissect the policy of price control, both as an economist, as a observer of public policy in the country, and I can tell you that in my view, it is fraught with challenges, particularly in the current circumstances, right? It is fraught with challenges, especially since this inflation is driven from abroad. Especially since we are going to self-generate inflation by virtue of the increase in surcharge, fuel surcharge, and by increasing in minimum wage. We're going to self-generate some inflation because of those things. Okay? So that's a reality. So the policy itself is fraught with some challenges. But on the politics of it, as a matter of calculation, as a matter of additions and multiplication, it's not as hard a calculation. So it's hard for the Free National Movement to make the case that the Davis administration is being arrogant in the face of making a political calculation was made by the FNM when the Menace administration was in office based on a number of things they did. It's hard to make that calculation, to say that they're acting arrogantly. I don't even believe it's arrogance. I believe it is a sheer political calculation. Sheer political calculation. The numbers are on the side of the story that said, I'm trying to do something for poor people. That's where the numbers are. The numbers are not with, oh, these poor grocers and these poor pharmacists are going to get hit from both sides. Their cost is going up and their profits are going down. That is not an argument that will have wide carriage in the broad population of voters in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. So as a political calculation, that one is easy. So some people have asked me, some people have said, Zhivargo, why do you think the government is persistent in acting in the way that it's acting and moving forward as it is moving forward? I said, because if you look at it from a political calculation point of view, from the point of view of a pairing to something that helps people in masses, then the government's calculation does not seem off to me. Not at all. If you want to have a analytical discussion about the policy and what might be the pros and cons of the policy and so forth and so forth, well, that's an argument for a few of us to make that ain't as sexy, don't have as much carriage as saying I'm doing something for people who are struggling. It just ain't. That's just the bottom line. Right? Arrogant? No, this ain't about arrogance. This ain't about thinking I'm better than nobody. This ain't about thinking that I don't have to listen to nobody. They are listening to somebody's. And the somebody's they're listening to is average souls who are thinking things out here are tough and somebody need to do something. And even if you do something that ain't really gonna do nothing, but it appears to be doing something, then you do that something. And boom, calculation says you're okay. Right? It is especially a difficult calculation. It is especially an easy calculation in light of a grouping struggling with a controversy in relation to Bermuda. You are not going to take on another bad issue, having made a decision that you believed to be in favor of lots of hurting people. You're not now going to reverse that decision in the face of other issues that are negative toward you. You have a number of things over the weeks that have been against you. You're not going to make a decision to reverse. And so, there you have it. There you have it. I mean, and why am I mentioning this to you? Because I want us to be practical about the realities of things. Right? Let's be practical about the reality of things. Right? When people have political office, they have many calculations to make. Okay? And you see sometimes they make calculations are not in your favor. So for instance, the government decided fuel surcharge has to go up and it's going to go up multiple times in several months. That's a hard decision to make and a unpopular decision to make, especially when delayed from a decision that should and could have been made in February. That would have been less costly, right? But you make the decision anyway. So the government makes a calculation. That's not about popularity. That's about the practical realities of governing. This organization that we have responsibility for shall not survive if we do not do something, and they did what the something was that was required to be done, right? That's hard-nosed governance. Some might argue delayed, but governance nonetheless. And then, now we're at the other side of it, well, you know, the economy ain't quite good, you know. I mean, I know we think the Bahamian economy is good. The Bahamian economy is not good. The Bahamian economy is recovering from a severe downturn, trying to struggle its way back up to its normal state of affairs. It is not good. Right? It's better than it was in the pandemic, substantially better than it was in the height of the pandemic, but it is not good. Right? But in that not good economy where businesses are still struggling, still trying to recover, they get to be hit with higher fuel charges and minimum wage. Why? Because the minimum wage is doing something for the poor people. They get hit with price control. Why? It's doing something for the public policy, higher fuel surcharge. Politics and some public policy, minimum wage increase, price control. You get to sort out what that plate of food, how that plate of food appeals to you. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll take a break. We'll be back.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today. The many options available to you with our merchant services, from click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches. Fidelity, we're
good for you. Girl, you see how Cora eye look funny all black up yesterday?
But she say she bump into a wall when she's running after the churn them.
Yeah, but last Saturday you see her arm was all black and blue, right?
What you saying? You think something wrong between her and Jack?
I ain't sure, but you know Jack is a jealous man. I hear him and Cora last Friday. I hear him say he hear Cora have eyes for Junior.
Now you know that ain't true. Cora is a good woman. Does mind her business, take care of them churn and go to church every Sunday. So what you think we should do?
I think we should report Jack, you know. Cora don't say nothing, but silence hides violence. And we don't want to line up in the cemetery.
Not me. I ain't getting in nobody business. Then Jack come after me.
And we could call or text Crime Stopper. And remember, we can even get some grocery money for our tip.
Remind me again how this work.
We can call them in Miami at 328 tips or 328-8477. Or when we in the island, call toll free at 300 tips or 300-8477. And if you don't have no minutes, use the Crack Crime Bahamas app and we could text them. And the messages get on mix up before it leave your phone so nobody can know what you saying.
So what we waiting on then? Let's go earn some grocery money.
Mr. Campbell, we have your test results. Do you want the good news or the bad news first?
Good news. No, wait, bad news. Give it to me straight, doctor.
Your blood work came back. You've got erythrocytes all over.
Oh no, this can't be happening.
Here's the good news. That just means red blood cells. It's a good thing. You're completely fine.
With 99% of medical claims paid in 5 days, we're like a doctor who doesn't want to be a comedian. CG Atlantic, medical in life. Good like that.
Loss of family members is very isolating, and people who have experienced loss appreciate when others have shared their grief. If you can't be there in person, go to the Nassau Guardian's website online at thenassauguardian.com and visit our obituary link. The obituary link allows you to read the funeral announcement, express condolences, or place photos on the online guestbook for one full year. Losing a loved one is painful, but that pain isn't the worst thing to happen. Friends, loved ones, colleagues, and neighbors who ignore the loss compound the pain. Should the bereaved family wish to place the obituary and photos on our obituary site, just contact the Guardian's funeral industry partners or the Nassau Guardian. Remember, there isn't one magic right thing to say to someone experiencing loss that will make the loss less painful or easier to bear. The Nassau Guardian's obituary link, available online at thenassauguardian.com.
Isn't it time you conquered your investment goals? With RF Mutual Funds, you can access a range of investments within a single fund. That means you get access to top-performing local stocks, along with exposure to international markets. Add expert management and competitive returns, like 25.16% with our targeted equity fund investment goals, you'll conquer them. Get started with RF Mutual Funds today at rfgroup.com.
Welcome back. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. If you want to give us a call, please feel free to do so on any of the following numbers. You can call us on 323-654-316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. So I was observing comments being made by people about Minister Wayne Monroe's comments about the Office of the Director of Public Prosecution, which is an independent office, and listening to people suggest that Mr. Monroe was, I think the opposition even hinted at this, was undermining the independence of the public prosecutor's office. And I have to say that I disagree with that. I mean, I could be wrong, but I disagree with that. Let me tell you why. I mean, I think independence is established by the fact that people can be at odds publicly with each other. like the courts could row the state, the legislature could disagree with the courts. The executive could disagree with the legislature. The executive could disagree with the courts, right? That's not, to me, in undermining or interference. If you disagree with the way an independent office carries out its job, your disagreement is proof that there is actually independence. Because if you were not independent, then I could go simply whisper in your ear and get you to do what I want you to do. And I wouldn't have to publicly criticize you for what you're doing. How do I get to say I'm undermining something that's independent by criticizing it? No, that's the whole point. And I don't like the way you're doing your job. You don't like the way I'm doing mine. That's cool. Now, if the government said, if this prosecution's office doesn't line itself up, we can defund it, we're going to get rid of you, we're going to change the law, and that would be interference. But that you get to say, I don't agree with the courts. I don't agree with the way you're approaching this. My officers don't agree. That's not unusual. Listen, man. Y'all ever watch LA, New York Undercover and them things? I'm sure you don't see the police officer rowing, police officers rowing with the prosecutor's office all the time about the way they're approaching the case. I just watched a movie. Just watched a movie. What movie was that now? It's called... And this was based on a true story. This was based on a true story. Oh, yes. Where this guy was accused of... This guy was suspected. This nurse, male nurse, was suspected of killing patient their IV drip with extra insulin and another chemical. And they had tracked his movements through several hospitals he had been in, hired with, but none of the hospitals would come out clean and say they suspected that he was doing what he was doing, because he tried to cover his track real good, right? But the police officers had come to a place where they believed they had enough to go after this guy, but the prosecutor's office said no, they couldn't do it, blah, blah, blah. And I recall in the movie, this is a true story, the one police officer said, the next person who dies is on you. So they don't have to agree, because the police could row all he wants. He can't make the prosecutor prosecute, and the prosecutor can't make the police not do its job, right? So if the minister responsible for national security says, I don't agree with the approach by the independent prosecutor's office, then okay. Now, do you like that he's saying something like that publicly? Maybe not, but you can't argue that that's undermining the office. In fact, it is establishing the bona fides of the independence of the office. Now, if he went around and told the attorney general and others, the minister of finance, and said, you know what, we need to do something with them and that kind of stuff, and we should hinder and hamper their situation, that's a different story. That's an entirely different story. But no, I didn't take it that way, you know? I didn't at all. I think that in expressing his officer's concerns about the approach, There you go. Remember when the courts were granting bail and sometimes in the face of the government attempting to stiffen the penalty, stiffen the conditions under which bail could be. How it was, the politicians were saying that the courts were, you know, taking measures that they did not agree with. It was clear the legislature did not agree with the courts in the attempt that they may have been administering the bail provisions. But so what? Chew your gum all, bite up your jaw all you want. The court is independent. They don't have to do what you say. And you don't have to do what they say. And if you want them to interpret the law differently, pass a new law so that it's clear the interpretation they have to make of the law. So I'm sorry, I didn't bite on that one, but I'm prepared to hear alternative arguments about it. All right, so we're gonna take a break. Yes, The Good Nurse. That's the name of the movie, The Good Nurse. That's right, thank you. That's right, The Good Nurse is the name of the movie. Yes, and somebody reminded me, the term I was looking for earlier was civil disobedience. That's right, civil disobedience. Man, you all are some sharp listeners on Z Live. Listen, we're gonna take a break for news. When we come back, we are going to continue our discussions, but at least later on in the show, if all goes well, I should have Dr. Jerry Horton, okay? So we'll be back after this news break. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing. If you feel like you've been down the same road,
this is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem, just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
To Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. So glad you could join us today. If you want to call us, the numbers are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. We have some text here. Let me read for you. It says, we all need lawyers at one time or another. Let's reduce lawyer fees by 45%. Lawyer fees are mostly perceived value anyway. Share the burden. Nada. Think about that now. What do you think would happen if the government says, you know what, let's for the next 3-6 months, price control lawyer fees, price control doctor fees, price control some other stuff. I mean, literally, really. I hope in the next 6 months she just like reduce VAT down to zero. VAT free for the next 6 months. And you stipulate that the price people cannot keep, that the price has to reflect that removal of VAT. This text says, if the law requires merchants to sell at a loss, they will liquidate their existing stock and discontinue the product. This results in shortage of products. That could be the case. This text says, Zhivargo, good afternoon. The Minister of Health and Economic Affairs are both saying that they implementation, but the pharmacists are saying that was not so. Where's the truth that you spoke about on your show? Yeah. We who were not there cannot say what in fact is the truth, right? So we can't say what is the truth. Now, I didn't gather that was what happened, but I mean, you know, I don't know. This text says the solution is to make bread basket 30%. What do you mean make bread basket 30%? What does that mean? Not too sure what you mean by that. Now, the government says, it's really odd to me. Like, so the government, like the news just indicated that the Attorney General said that a resolution has been arrived at between the pharmacist and the government, right? But the Prime Minister and the Minister of Economic Affairs tells the pharmacists and them, you know, you must obey the rules. What does that mean? I mean, like, why are you negotiating a situation where, listen, man, we've determined what is the case and this is what is going to be the case. Now we're told there is a resolution. So if the pharmacists weren't happy with the circumstances before, the resolution is what? Maybe the controls stay in place, but maybe they have a longer period of time for implementation or something of that nature. Okay, great. You know, you don't want these things lingering out there indefinitely, because that's not going to be good for. That's not going to be good for anybody. So also, I was observing that the government is saying that the fiscal deficit for 2022-2023 first quarter was slashed by $116 million year over. Okay, so let's get this. Let's be clear in our heads what the government is saying. So government is saying, so the first quarter of the last fiscal year, remember the government's fiscal year runs from July 1 of a year. So that would have been July 1 of 2021 to June 30th of 2022. So the first quarter of the year for the government would have been July, August, and September of 2021, right? So, and the government is saying that the deficit in that quarter was $116 million higher than it is in the same quarter, July, August, September of 2022, right? Surprising. No, not surprising, because again, you know, 2020 remained a year subdued by the pandemic and only the beginnings of the reopening of the economy. But a $161 million shrinkage in the deficit year over year is good news. It's great news, really great news, right? Because you don't want the opposite to be the case, right? And so that's really good news that the deficit is coming down year over year, first quarter to first quarter. We will have to see what that means for the second, third, and fourth quarters, but you know, you can't spit at good news. That's good news. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Minister.
Hey, how you doing, sir?
Richard Olenor, Pop here. Good afternoon to your listeners.
Good to hear
from you. Like you said just now, and I like to make sure I try to understand. You have a question, right? Sound like you're saying, from before Dr. Minister called the last election in September last year, starting from January or July last year, to this July last year, you know, we say governance, or they say governance is continuous. Sometimes what he was saying, Mr. Davis, them, my new day government can't take the credit for opening up the country, because before they ran, the government was starting to open up. So it sounds like you saying, and I could be wrong, that congratulations to both of them governments from what they started from the pandemic, trying to open up. We ain't where we need to be, but we head in the right direction. That's what you're saying?
You exactly read me right.
My prime minister, thank you, Minister Laing. My prime minister, Mr. Davis, is a lawyer. I never know him to be accountant or nothing, but I know he cares about people. And I hear you talk about what you observe about him over the years, just like a lot of us over the years. So we know he compassionate and care about us, but he's not an accountant. And I believe he have businesses. They say you should shut up if you never run a business because you don't know what it is to take to run a business, to order things, and to do all of that. But Mr. Davis, they say, Heavy's the crown or something like that.
Heavy's the head that wears the crown. Fighting.
I want you to correct me if I'm wrong. Lead me in the right direction if it's possible. I want to know what side. I pick a side. I want to know if I'm on the wrong side or what. It sounds like Mr. Davis fighting for us, the average person. The cost of living and stuff like that. The inflation and all the stuff they talking about. Sound like he asking the grocers and others to take a little drop, a little loss in income. What you call it, revenue or profit, to take a little loss with it. And maybe for 3 months or 6 months, I'm not sure all the months them. Now my question to you, right? Should we side on Mr. Davis saying he's fighting for us? Or should we have an open mind? Some of them smart people, like I say, accountants, and I ask you this because I believe you're working fired off this phone now. I don't want to know. Do you think it's sensible, like the people are saying, just take the water off the food? Just take the water off the medicine? But the smart people say, don't do that. They say, Papa, so much people in this country what don't pay no taxes. Benefit from everything, the school building, the free school, the free medicine, everything. Say the only way the government can get something is they do a little what. Because I was one of them who say, take the water off the medicine, take the water off the groceries. I asking you, if you think Prime Minister Davis should do what some of them smart people say, just take the water off, or continue to do what he doing to fight for us poor people. It seems like he's fighting for us. I gang up and listen. Thank you, Minister.
Papa, listen to me, man. Your question is a brilliant one. It is a brilliant question. It's a trap. But it's a brilliant question. It really is a brilliant question, right? Now, let me just fix something here. Prime Minister Davis, or any other Minister of Finance, does not have to be a financial or economic expert to be Minister of Finance. That's not true. That's absolutely not true. What any minister, because Glenisanna Martin is a lawyer. She's not an educator, as far as I'm aware. But she's a lawyer, and she's a minister of education. And quite frankly, she's very passionate in doing, I think, a good job. So you don't have to be a minister with expertise in that particular area. Is Obi Wilchcombe an expert in social services policy? Is any of these ministers in any number of areas particular experts in that? Not the attorney general. You know, you don't have to be a lawyer, you know, but typically will be a lawyer. You know what I mean? Wayne Monroe is no national security expert as far as I'm aware, but he's minister responsible. So you don't have to be an expert. Your job is to advance government policy. Once you know what the policy is, you have experts there. You have a director of economics. You have a financial secretary who's an expert in these areas supposed to be. You have technical directors and stuff. So they are your experts, and you can hire other experts if you want from outside the government and outside the country even. So let's dispense with that myth. You don't have to be an accountant. You don't have to be an economist. You don't have to be a financial guru to be a minister of finance. That's absolutely not so. Anna was minister of finance of the country for quite some time. He was a lawyer. Paul Adley was. He was a lawyer and so forth. And some people may say, oh, well, that's why we mess up. That's not true. That's absolutely not true. But, you know, if you want to carry that narrative, that's fine. So the question Papa asked, though, you see that the prime minister is fighting for you. That I said it earlier. You cannot deny that what the government is posturing itself to do is to alleviate, to try to reduce the burden the public is experiencing. So you can't deny that that is the case. But remember, I indicated, just because your aims are good does not mean that the strategy or approach you take will in the end not turn around and be maybe as burdensome for the people you're trying to help as the thing that you are seeking to do. So should the prime minister do what he's doing? I can't say whether he should or should not do what he's doing. I don't think that price control is good policy. I do not. I'm telling you as my personal expertise, I don't think it's good policy. I think it is antiquated. It is antithetical to free enterprise, and it undermines in the end, it undermines efficient and effective delivery of quality, best price services to the public and goods to the public. That's my belief on the matter. Should you take VAT off the bread basket of all the items? I do not believe that to be a good policy either, because there are lots of people who could afford the circumstances we are in even now. And if you say, I'm not going to make them pay VAT and then rob the government of that revenue, you're going to expand the deficit and create more issues for yourself along down the road and so forth. So I don't believe that's good policy either. I believe the best policy is be targeted about the people who are in need of your help and provide some cash transfers to those people where they clearly have been disadvantaged by something beyond their control. That's what I believe. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
So, Laing, Zhivargo, how are you?
Hey, I'm okay. And how are you?
I'm fine, man. Doing well. Listen, I Excellent. Thought about the past administration. I remember when Dr. Minnis mentioned about, and the government said, there'll be tough times to come and tough mm-hmm. decisions to be made.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, yes. are we in this era now, in this season, where the Progressive Liberal Party government is faced with this time? At the time, what other ways they can deal with it? I mean, you mentioned it just now, by dealing with those individuals, you know, who we can help. But is this that time?
Yeah, well, I mean, clearly, I think there's no question these are tough times and tough decisions are having to be made in these times. You have decisions that have to be made about BPL, NID, about what to do with VAT, no VAT, how to respond to inflation, you know what I mean? So, yeah, these are clearly tough times and clearly hard decisions have to be made. As to what else, and what are the options that confront the government in terms of meeting the demands of these times, let me tell you, first of all, I believe that the government of the Bahamas ought always to try and be compassionate and assist where it can. But the government of the Bahamas need also to speak clearly to people that it is unable to alleviate every discomfort brought upon by external shocks beyond its control.
If you'd
and
like.
That, and that in the shocks, we all have to make adjustments, maybe some uneasy, maybe some difficult adjustments, to be able to survive in that difficult period. And so I believe the government ought to take a stand that reflects that, okay? So let's all share the burden. Let's all share the burden. Let's cut down some of the expenses then. Let's reduce the intake extracted from the society by way of taxes for another six months, like the businesses are being asked to do. Let's do that. Let's demonstrate by our behavior to the public that we are cutting back because the times demand these kinds of adjustments. Okay? The poor people that have to be helped, let's not spend in a certain area and divert those funds to the poor. Let's have that additional $20, $30, $40 million to the poor. Let's not cuddle our business community from competition, but allow better competition to come in and let that fight in the competition drive prices down for consumers. Inform consumers about their power to make choices that can inform businesses that I am not going to do that. I'm not going to buy that stuff because it's too expensive. And let that choice drive the business people to do something different. People say, oh, if you never run a business, you can't tell nobody how to run a business. That's nonsense. Let me tell you why. If you're a customer, you don't run the people business, but you could tell them, listen, that product or service you sell, that's some stinking nasty product and service. And if you don't stop, you are going to go out of business. You wouldn't listen to them because they don't ever run a business before. That's nonsense. People can tell you about their experience with your business who never ran a business before. They can give you good ideas. Do you know that some of McDonald's best ideas for improving itself came from the people who work at McDonald's who don't own it or run it? Absolutely. And that's why some of their people have gone on to become some of the most significant business people in the world. So don't let anybody fool you with that. That just because that you haven't done this, just because you haven't done that means you can't. I've never murdered before, but you think I'm going to tell somebody, if I say to somebody, you know, you really shouldn't murder me because I never murdered before. Really? If somebody never ran a business before, but encourages somebody to go into business, like their children, does that mean that they shouldn't because they never ran a business before? No, right? We can take and stride the guidance and advice and instruction people give us based on their experience. But it doesn't mean because you have a lack of experience that you can't speak to an issue. You just have to weigh the extent to which you believe what the person is saying to you makes sense or not. Right? Just because people run businesses before don't mean they can run another successful business. Don't let me start calling some names, right? Some of us have run businesses. Some of them have done okay. Some of them have failed. That's life. Right? So, you know, we can do things to survive this period, but it seems to me that what we are trying to do is survive this period without losing any comfort. That's what it seems to me, that we are trying to survive this period without sacrifice. The we are trying to survive this period without feeling any pain. Well, if that's possible, more power to us. If it's not, well, we'll see. Producer, I don't think we have another caller on the line, eh? No? Okay. So what we're going to do is, if all goes well for me, I should have some guests joining me after our break. If not, we will continue our discussion. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
I marched the car. The lady run into me marched the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang! Yo, send them pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Isn't it time you conquered your investment goals? With RF Mutual Funds, you can access a range of investments within a single fund. That means you get access to top-performing local stocks, along with exposure to international markets. Add expert management and competitive returns like 25.16% with our targeted equity fund, and you won't just meet your investment goals, you'll conquer them. Get started with RF Mutual Funds today at rfgroup.com.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options, here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday. If you want to call us, the numbers to call us are 323-6232 or 325-4316 or 325-4259. You can text us on 422-4796 or you can WhatsApp me on 439-3043. I have a text here, says, Laing, what some people fail to understand is if you take off VAT off bread basket items, the rich benefit too. Our tax system has to change. Right now, there is no duty on many breadbasket items, but prices are still high, and I can bet you my life, if you remove VAT of those items, prices will still not go down. This is why there has to be some price control. I can bet you now, if you remove VAT of eggs, they will only go $4 per dozen. $4 per dozen? Where are you buying eggs from now? The eggs, I paid $6.99 for eggs per dozen in Freeport the other day. So these places are already comfortable making big money. If you remove VAT off eggs with customs duty already eliminated, eggs should go to less than $2, but that will never happen. Trust me. Well, I am not so pessimistic as you are, because it wasn't too long. We were paying basically the price of eggs just skyrocketed. And I want you all to know, in the United States of America, I shop in the U.S. from time to time, and the prices have shocked me. They're definitely not our prices, but they have gone up relative to where they were. So inflation is real, okay? So I'm not even denying that inflation is a phenomena that is impacting upon our financial situation in the country. I do not also deny that some merchants may be taking advantage of this inflationary period to rack up some prices and get some more profits for themselves to recover from some losses that they may have experienced during the pandemic. So I'm not denying that either. But I also think that they are just faced with these basic higher prices also. And if VAT was taken off, I don't share your view that the prices wouldn't go down. I really don't. I think that there would be some reduction, but I think that that was some hardship for the government that's not necessary to be done. It is not necessary for the government to remove VAT off of bread basket items. And it's not necessary for them to do it simply because the rich also benefit, because that's what we have this classist sometimes tendency in the way we approach some issues. It's not just the rich that benefits from it, because you don't have to be rich, but you can have a substantial enough income that you are not poor, right? You're a great solid middle income person with some cash to spare, and you will benefit from VAT as well. And cutting the VAT means that you who could pay it will not be paying it, and then therefore we increasing pressures on the government's deficit spending, right? So it's not a question of the rich. What does it mean to be rich? What does that mean? Relative to some people in lots of places in the world, you are exceptionally rich, and you may not in your own mind be rich. But what do we mean? We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Hi, how you doing?
You know, in regard to the price of eggs, mm-hmm. Mr. Roberts warned us several months ago because there was an outbreak of some kind of bird flu or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So he did say that the egg prices would be going up. Right? So
the price is up. There ain't no question about that.
But my other point is, you know, I know that the government has a hard task of balancing the economy and you know, trying to get making everyone happy or trying to keep the majority people happy. Like you say, governments or, you know, political parties, they are looking for popularity so they can more or less win the next term in governance, right? But at the same time, in my opinion, I feel that the government need to lead by example. The Prime Minister made a speech several months ago that all of us must be frugal in how we spend our money.
Mm-hmm.
The government should also lead by example in how...
But you don't think the government being frugal?
Mr. Lai, come on now. Come on. you know what they call the PLP, the party, the government has to manage. If we are, and I know revenues are so-called up and whatnot, tourists are coming in and forth, but the government has to show the people, I'm in this with you. We are going to go through this together. You know, the government needs the business. We need the business. All of us need the business. Okay, because that's capitalism, okay? We're not a socialist country, and so the government must be very careful how it, you know, handles businesses and so on and so forth. Because my thing is, where does it stop with this price control? You know, the other day, a young man was on the radio and say how he lost his house because the bank took it and whatnot. Is the government going to regulate the banks and the mortgages and the interest rate that banks can charge on mortgages as well, and so on and so forth? So it has to be very careful in how it tries to balance.
Tell the construction guys how much to charge for plumbing work, for laying blocks, for doing carpentry, for doing,
you know,
the electrical.
If the building prices is $150 a square feet, you can tell them y'all can only charge $50, and the cost of their material and everything else is going up.
But let's look at this, because you raise a very good point. Let's look. Is there anything more basic than shelter?
I mean, food. I mean,
food and water, right?
Other than food
and water, right? And clothing,
right.
You could argue, right?
Right?
But everybody got to have shelter, right? You don't want people exposed to the elements.
Right.
Then why would we not put controls on all the rents? On all the mortgages?
Right. And, you know, and make it affordable so that these landlords, according to them, don't make all this money. But you got to understand, the landlord has a mortgage too. You mean, you know, the landlord may be paying a mortgage that, you know, just he only making, you know. And so he has to charge in order to cover himself. So, you know, you got to be very careful how you try to balance society. Yes, you want to be popular. Yes, you want to try to please everybody, but you can never be able to please everybody. And I with you, you know, everybody don't sell things high, you know, Mr. Lang. If you go down to some shop, you can find something a little cheaper. If you go down here, you can find something cheaper. Yeah, it may cost you a little time or maybe even a little bit of gas, but you got to shop around. And whoever have the lowest prices, let the competition drive the prices. Open up the market, like you say, and let there be competition, and the prices will go down because, you know, everybody wants to stay in business, so they can try to lower their price in order to make something. That's the way I see it. Instead of trying to, one of the grocers said, I think it was Mr. Roberts, said the same thing. You know, the competition will drive the prices. You know, this is a global thing. This is just not in the Bahamas.
But now here's the thing, though, bro. Here's the thing. Do they really want competition? Because right now, in the Bahamas. Like when our grocers shop for us abroad, right? When they shop for us abroad, do they not have a worldwide set of competitors who they can purchase from?
I would think so. Uh-huh.
Okay, so the people they buy from have to compete with people, right?
Right.
But they don't compete with people all around the world. Oh, they only compete with Bahamians. They only compete with Bahamians.
Yeah, but I mean. Allow more people or allow foreigners or allow people to come inside with lower prices, you know.
I'm just saying, one of the things,
and I could get into a little history, the reason why the West Indian sugar lost its savor because they were protected in the English market. But when the industrialists came to Parliament, they decided that we're going to remove the protectionist policy on West from all over the world to compete with mm-hmm. and because the West Indian sugar was of inferior quality because they had been in production so longer, the planters eventually went out of business. So what about the banana,
the Caribbean banana people?
Yeah, same thing. You know, it destroyed some people in the process, but competition makes you better, man. You know? Mm-hmm. Competition, that means that you got to fight harder, you know, you got to fight harder to be the best, you know. Competition is good, man.
You mentioned taking the lead. You know, I went into a store with my son yesterday in a gas station, and he went to get a drink, and I knew he was going to go get something to drink because he had been playing basketball. I picked him up from school, right. And so I didn't mind, but then he picked up a drink. He picked up this Welch's grape juice. And when he carried to the counter, the woman tell him it was $3.79. I said, who you think paying for that? Not me.
the reason why
I did that was I could pay for it. I tried to teach my son, buddy, life ain't don't work like that. It don't work like that. You know, you have to make changes when circumstances press on you differently.
Right.
So and what we don't do is we keep trying. The message we send to ourselves broadly is this: hard. I'm gonna shelter you from hard times. I'm gonna keep you from stuff tough. I'm gonna protect you from having to deal with people that maybe more productive than you.
And, you know, sometimes we make it so easy, and for people that it makes them complacent. You know, somebody said this. On a U.S. station, that the problems in America started when they said that we're going to declare war on poverty, and they started to give handouts and so-called hands-up to people. And you know what happened? The people sat down and waited on the handout. They waited on Uncle Sam. They went and they had their anchor babies and whatnot, and they didn't go to work, and they waited on the welfare, and they waited on
And there are some genuine poor you have to help, but you're absolutely right.
Yeah, but
there
you don't some... help those. And, yeah, you know, exactly. Like, exactly. Everybody don't exactly. need help, Mr.
Exactly
Mr.
right.
Everybody, you're isolate exactly. those persons who you're need exactly the help right. and help them. You know, exactly everyone right. is not in the same.
You're exactly right.
You know, you're, help those exactly that need. Right. And the grocer said, we will give 10% more for on the food stamp, if it's food. But, yeah. you know, Mr. Lang, I live in the ghetto, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And ghetto people mm-hmm. don't buy food like that. If they scrap on $10, they go to Wendy's. Or they're going to the Chinese restaurant to buy.
Who
they're going to somebody to say, you know, let me go buy something.
Who you telling?
so, you know, this ain't really affecting, you know, the so-called ghetto people. Because when they hustle something, they can run to the Chinese restaurant, buy one stuff, right, something, and whatever.
And when you ever think tuna and grits is poor people food?
You know.
That's a regular breakfast for some of us.
Yes.
Sardine
and grits.
Yeah. So,
you know, come on. We have to, and I agree with Mr. Pintard, do your studies first, you know, see where you really need to put your resources, you know. Do your studies in the society and see who really need the help and give those people the help.
I appreciate you calling, man, always.
Thank you, Dad.
Thank you. You know, this Texas says, listen, the government is finally going. The government is finally doing to everyone what they did to bus owners for 20 years. People made 1 million excuses for why the buses didn't need a raise. Now the pretty pharmacy owners get similar treatment and it's foul. That's a very good point. I can't argue that point at all. Very good point. We have another call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hello, good afternoon, Mr. Lang.
Hi, good afternoon. So how are you doing?
Just wanted to touch on the issue of Sandy Down. I don't think you're speaking about that today, or?
Sorry, go ahead. You were going to, I missed that, but touch on.
Perhaps the idea of the government, what they could do to try to solve this issue or this problem, instead of having all of these court injunctions that prohibited them from demolishing these Shanty Town buildings and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. The government is the ones that issue the work permit, correct?
Yeah, but people are building without permits sometimes.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is they are building without permit, but most of the people that live in these shanty towns, a lot of them have work permits, I would assume, right?
Okay, yes, okay, yeah. Uh-huh.
So what I would suggest to the government is the fact that before you issue a work permit, let these people show proof of living accommodation in a solid structure.
Mm.
Rented, like, for example, apartment owned by the inmate, let the landlord present, give them a letter and a copy of their passport to say that the landlords are the inmate. And before they issue any work permit, they have to show these things. So, like that, they bypass all of these laws and then they solve the problem at the same time. I mean, it might be done overnight, but it'll be in steps. So government have the sole authority now in terms of granting the work permit without any type of court issue. So
that's
and solve the problem.
That's a very good idea. In fact, though, every work permit is sponsored. Most work permits are sponsored. So why should not the burden of housing be on the person sponsoring the permit? Because if I bring you in and I can pay you $200-something a week, you really think I can find housing accommodations under that payment?
Exactly. And that's what I'm saying. Before a work permit is issued, show proof of you are living in a solid structure that is abiding by the Bahamas Building Code and eventually...
They do that in Canada and some other places.
So that's what we need to do. Simple. Yeah. It's a simple process. You don't have the burden of having to go to court and justice, saving the country millions of dollars, paying lawyers, settling all kind of...
It ain't as simple as you say, because remember now, somebody therefore has to do that inspection, right? And, you know, and come on.
Yeah, but you could set aside. You just have how much recruits, yes, I just saw the papers, right? How much are people have a section or assign a certain amount of officers that deals with that type of with that particular paperwork itself, right?
Yeah, but I remember the volume of work, you know. I'm saying to you, because you and I both know this, that what matters is that people enforce correctly so that someone don't slip somebody something so that somebody could get a permit.
Well, what I'm saying is it will be a slow process, but
yeah.
At least it will be a process. But at the same time, if someone is fine breaking the law, whether it be an immigration officer or a landlord, someone that gives a letter that is not reflecting truth, then they should be fine, levy the fine, and let the fine start where it is. But you have to start somewhere.
We have started somewhere. Because we have started somewhere. Because we are not a country without laws. We are picking up illegal persons. We do have a detention center. We do repatriate people. We do have immigration officers who go out there and pick up people. We do have something. But the idea you issued, I think, is a good idea.
Yeah, idea. I know we have the laws and stuff, but I mean, in terms of trying to get rid of the towns and stuff.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. I think it's a great idea.
Yeah, I think it'll help, you know.
Yeah, I do. I agree with you. Thank you very much.
All right, John. Thank you.
Okay, man. We got a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller. All right. Well, producer, let's take that final break. Pay our respects to our sponsors, and then when we come back, we'll wrap up. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem. Just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Mash the car. The lady run into me, mash the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull up the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Girl, you see how Cora eye look funny all black up yesterday?
But she say she bump into a wall when she's running after the churn them.
Yeah, but last Saturday, you see her arm was all black and blue, right?
What you saying? You think something wrong between her and Jack?
I ain't sure, but you know Jack is a jealous man. I hear him and Cora last Friday. I hear him say he hear Cora have eyes for Junior.
Now, you know that ain't true. Cora is a good woman. Does mind her business, take care of them churn and go to eat. So what you think we should do?
I think we should report Jack, you know. Cora don't say nothing, but silence hides violence, and we don't want to line up in the cemetery.
Not me. I ain't getting in nobody business. Then Jack come after me, and I line up next to Cora.
No, man, we could call or text Crime Stopper. And remember, we can even get some grocery money for our tip.
Remind me again how this work.
We can call them in Miami at 328-TIPS or 328-8477. Or when we in the island, call toll-free at 300-TIPS or 300-8477. And if you don't have no minutes, use the Crack Crime Bahamas app, and we could text them. And the messages get on mix-up before it leave your phone, so nobody can know what you're saying.
So what are we waiting on then? Let's go earn some grocery money.
Mr. Campbell, we have your test results. Do you want the good news or the bad news first?
Good news. No, wait, bad news. Give it to me straight, doctor.
Your blood work came back. You've got erythrocytes all over.
Oh no, this can't be happening.
Here's the good news. That just means red blood cells. It's a good thing. You're completely fine.
With 99% of medical claims paid in 5 days, we're like a doctor who doesn't want to be a comedian. CG Atlantic, medical in life. Good like that.
Isn't it time you conquered your investment goals? With RF Mutual, access to a range of investments within a single fund. That means you get access to top-performing local stocks, along with exposure to international markets. Add expert management and competitive returns by 25.16% with our targeted equity fund, and you won't just meet your investment goals, you'll conquer them. Get started with RF Mutual Funds today at rfgroup.com.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Thursday afternoon. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
How are you doing?
Good, man. And yourself?
That's good. There's a lot of talk about taking off the water and stuff off of these. Medication and stuff like that, right? And I see those, the grocers and the pharmacy. But one person I never hear is government talk about. The numbers, man. They make millions. Does anybody collect anything from them?
Yeah, they pay taxes.
But believe me, Mr. Lang, the average people, in the United States today, there's a lottery. That's $107 billion. Nobody in the Bahamas can ever tell
one,
you.
It's $1 billion.
A millionaire from playing numbers out here.
It's $1 billion. One billion.
Yeah. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody in the Bahamas could walk up to you and say, I am a millionaire since I sense the number man and become legal.
They'll tell you that?
They can't. They can't, Mr. Lang. I gamble too. Believe me.
Right.
I know
but,
the trick.
But guess what? But guess what? Let me ask you a question. See, because don't get it mixed up now. A national lottery, a state lottery is not the same as a gambling operation. No, hold on. Have you ever heard anybody say they went to Las Vegas and came out and was a millionaire?
In Las Vegas?
Yeah.
Yeah, man. No, you're not going to get away.
I watch programs
on TV. There are people who are millionaires three and four times.
No, that's not what I asked you. That's not what I asked you.
I asked you this.
I'm 55 years old, sir.
But I'm older than you.
Listen to me.
I'm telling you, nobody in this country could walk up to you today and say, since the number man's done become legal, I am a millionaire.
And I'm asking you a very simple question. State lottery, have you ever heard somebody say, I walked into a casino in Las Vegas and walked out a millionaire?
But Mr. Lang, you really serious?
But I'm dead serious. I'm asking you the question.
But,
have you ever heard it?
These things you could watch. You could go online and find out. You could Google these things and find out.
That somebody walked into a casino and walked out a million.
Yeah.
Won a million. Oh, yeah? Wow. Okay, bro.
There are people out here inside a casino. Out here win millions of dollars.
In the casino?
Right on Paris Island.
In the casino?
I can tell you that.
Really? Okay.
Believe me, I tell you.
I stand to be corrected, sir. We're not debating it no more.
When the number man get 70% and I get 30, how much do you think I can make? Let's move on.
I concede the point to you. I'm not a gambler, so you tell me you know. Okay, no problem. Is there anything else? All right. We got some... text on the line. Hi, Mr. Lang. This government is playing politics with money, the money of businesses and the ignorance of the citizens. Most people of the Bahamas have no idea of the cause and effect of what the government has done. The citizens only know that some things are not going up. Why don't the PM raise taxes on real estate and such things? He would not do it because of pushback But the Haymans, he will demand payment. All the best, says that texter. Lord, I get all these texts at the last minute. Okay. The text says, Mr. Laing, the Department of Labor should enforce the law and stop approving labor certificates after someone has worked in the country for after 3 years. Persons have been working in the country on work permit brought to the immigration when they are caught. All right. We have another caller. You telling me, producer? Another caller? See, I work in casino. Winning a million is common. Okay. All right. See, there's somebody telling me. I told you I stand to be corrected. This texter, you mean they lost a million in the casino? No, somebody say you actually winning $1 million in the casino is common, they tell me. Say, great show as usual, Mr. Laing, going up to $1.5 billion. Mr. Laing, that man watched too much Ocean 11. Everyone know the house always win. All righty then, Lexington, man. We plumb out of time. This says, actually, the Davis administration reversed the increased gaming tax last year that the Minnesota administration levied. Mr. Laing, many guests win millions in both our casinos. I concede the point, folks. I concede the point. The text says the prime minister is a big hypocrite. He wants the pharmacists and the grocery store owners to obey the rules, but his dark day administration wouldn't obey the rules concerning the Procurement Act. We still don't know how much in millions of dollars in contract was given out from September 16th last year, says that person. He got you on that one. Laugh out loud, Gracia. Yeah, he got me on that one. I ain't on that one. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. This is y'all. Have a great evening. God bless. We'll talk to you again tomorrow. God spares life.
Everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand.